In the 14th lecture, we saw finite element method procedure through the discretization method, right? And there we saw how do we calculate the energy associated with the entire domain, right? We had taken 3 element example with 4 nodes, and then we calculated energy, and then we also saw properties of shape functions of the various nodes. But now, if you really look at the procedure that we followed for calculating the energy, it was really not amenable for coding, particularly for 2D or 3D. Why? Because we calculated, you know, energy for the entire domain at once, is it not? We were integrating from 0 to 3L. You remember that? We are integrating from 0 to 3L, and then depending upon whether shape function is 0, not 0, accordingly we were, is it not? We were either taking some terms, we are not taking some terms. But that is not good from the point of view of coding. So from coding point of view, you know, it will be easy if we go element wise, we calculate energy element wise, and then form first element coefficient matrix, and then combined element coefficient matrices. It is one and the same thing, we are doing the same, finally we are integrating the energy. But we are first calculating the element coefficient matrices, because we are calculating the energy of each element with contributions of shape functions and the corresponding potentials associated with only that element, right? And then we combine element coefficient matrices to form global coefficient matrix. That is what we will do now, right? So here, that is why we are taking only first element, say phi 1 phi 2, and with node numbers 1 and 2, and this is element number 1. So, now we will calculate only energy associated with only this first element, right. So, that is why it is here only integral 0 to L, right. And then it is, we know the, what is the expression for energy, it is phi dash, integral phi dash square minus integral phi h dx, is it not? So, phi dash here is, now we have seen in the previous lecture that your phi for this first element will be simply n1 phi 1 plus n2 phi 2, is it not? For the first element, potential will be n1 phi 1 plus n2 phi 2, because n3 and phi 3, n3 and n4 are 0 for element 1. So, then simply for this will have only 2 terms, n1 of 1 dash phi 1 plus n2 1 dash, dash means it is derivative. Last time we discussed that derivative will be valid only for the shape function, because they are the functions of x. Phi 1 and phi 2, they are not functions of x, because this is a variational procedure. We are varying the values of phi at every x, right. So, this will be the phi dash square. And this is n h dx, right? Phi h dx. This is phi, phi h dx, and h stands for the source term. So now we will form the element level matrices. So now you will get a 1 1 and a 2 2 by using the same procedure. This is not going to real. It will be the same. Instead, we will, what we have done is we have just gone element level. So, then you will get a 1 1 and a 2 2 of element 1 as 1 over L. So, here in the previous case, we had got, when it was this a 2 2 total was contribution, when we considered the node 2, the contribution was 2 by L, is it not? Because that 2 was common to both element 1 and element 2. But here, since we are taking only first element, a 2 2 will be only 1 by L. When we take the second element, again A2, that for the second element, this will be the, this node number will be corresponding to node number 1 of that second element, is it not? So, there again it will come 1 by L, and that 1 by L and this 1 by L will get added to form to get 2 by L, and that will be the total contribution of node 2. That will give the corresponding energy of, because of potential at node 2, is it not? Is this point clear? So here, that's why 822 is only 1 by L, because the other contribution of
potential at node 2 in the second element is yet to be accounted for.
That will get accounted when we consider the second element, is it not? But this makes it very simple. Now you can see, imagine if you go element wise in coding, when you develop your own code, it becomes very easy. You know, you just consider an element, you set up a do loop and go element wise, calculate element coefficient matrix, and then later on you form the global coefficient matrix, right? So how do we do that? That we will see. And then this A12 and A21 will remain same as earlier, minus 1 by L, right? So these are the four terms, and B1 and B2 will again remain HL by 2. So there is no change. Similarly, for now element 2, which will be, you know, so if this is 2, then this will be phi 2 and phi 3. With these, this will be node 2 and this will be node 3, and then you will get N2 dash phi 2 plus N3 dash phi 3 here, is it not? And similarly here, and then this will be A2 2 2 and A3 3 2 will be 1 by L, and then you know, you will have this A2 3 and A3 2 as minus 1 by L, and then correspondingly, you know, these terms will remain same, right? So now we go further, and then similarly for element 3, it will be A3 3 and A4 4. Now those will be, you know, again 1 by L. So all these element coefficient matrices are identical in this case. So that is the advantage, right? So in this case, it becomes very simple. So the three element coefficient matrices will be 1 by L and this matrix. Similarly, the B matrices, which are representing the source term, will be again HL into 0.5, 0.5, right? So now what we have to do is, we have to combine the element coefficient matrices to form the global coefficient matrix, which will actually basically add the energies of all the elements together, and then the contributions of the nodal potentials will automatically get added, is it not? So then here you have this, these are the three element coefficient matrices. Three A matrices are this three, except, you know, 1 by L is not considered here. 1 by L of course is there, but that is common, so that is not considered. So these three matrices, now these are what are written here, these are the node numbers, these are sort of global node numbers, because element number 1 is between 1 and 2, element number 2 is between 2 and 3, and element number 3 is between 3 and 4, right? So then, you know, you have in element number 1, this is A22. For element number 3, this is A22, is it not? So when we combine this A22 and this A22 has to get added, because remember, the energy, overall energy is just one scalar number, is it not? It is a scalar quantity. So all these things will get added to give only one number energy. So all these terms will get added. So that means you have to collect terms with same coefficients. So that's why this and this gets added. That's why the contribution of node 2 becomes 2 in the global coefficient matrix, whereas contribution of node number 1 remains 1, because A11 doesn't appear anywhere here except this A11. Similarly, A33 appears here as well as here. So that gets added, you get 2. A44 is only appearing once, that's why you get 1 here, right? And then, you know, your off diagonal elements will remain as, so this is like A12, this is A21. So A12 is minus 1, A21 is minus 1. So that is corresponding to these two elements. So this is how we have formed, we have got the same global coefficient matrix as earlier, but it was now so easy. If we had gone, if we go as per this element wise, it becomes very easy. So you have to calculate, you have to set up a do loop in when you code, and you know, you have to calculate element wise this coefficient matrix. So you know, you have to just set up a do loop and do it, and then combine. So later on, when we actually see the code, we'll see how easy it is. So just wait till that time. Okay. So in fact, in the next after this is over, we are going to show you one code written in Scilab, which will make things more clear. Similarly, for the B matrix on the right hand side, which is the source, again you know it is 3 B matrices. Again, HL is not considered here because it's just common. So 0.5, 0.5. So now again same thing. This is B2. Here also it is B2. B3, B3. So B2 and B3, 0.5 plus 0.5 becomes 1. So the contribution becomes 1 for node number 2 and 3. Again, why? Because those nodes, node numbers 2 and 3 are common, right? And that is how you get this B matrix. Now these two matrices are same as earlier, right? Okay, so now we will see one more thing, that is what we have seen till now. This procedure was for Poisson's equation, right? So we considered Poisson's equation. Now you know we will consider non-homogeneous wave equation, where you have phi term here, right? And then this x comes on this side, and that represents the source. Earlier we were taking h as the source, so h was constant. That means everywhere in the domain there is same source. Now here source is there and is function of x, is it not? So source is function of x, it is not constant, right? And so, and we have earlier seen this the form will be when we actually saw the global approximation, wherein you know whole domain approximation we saw. There it was AC minus D, C is equal to B. You remember that? AC minus DC is equal to B, where C were the unknown coefficients in that whole polynomial expression. So that now what we have done, we have gone from that approach, whole domain approach, to elemental level approach. So now those C coefficients are replaced by the potentials at nodes. So that is why that final equation becomes A phi minus D phi equal to B. So now A is already evaluated in the previous lecture, because this del square phi is there, whether it is in wave equation or in the Poisson's equation or even in the Laplace equation. When you follow the FEM procedure, that will result into the same global coefficient matrix A,
if geometry and material properties are the same.
So what actually needs to be, you know, what we need to form matrix corresponding to is phi, because we have already worked out for del square phi, that is A matrix, in the previous, you know, 2-3 slides we saw that, is it not, and the previous lecture. So now we have to worry about this phi, and then also about x, because earlier the source was constant, it was not varying with x. Now source is function of x, right? So now how do we, you know, form the D matrix? So in the functional, the extra term that corresponds to D matrix is half phi square dx. Remember, the functional, you take phi on this side and then you know multiply by phi, that is the phi square, integral phi square dx is the, and multiplied by half is the term that appears in the functional. Remember, the functional for this, when it was you know, we discussed this in one of the previous slides, when you study previous lecture, you will find that this becomes, when this comes on this side, it will be minus phi. Minus phi becomes phi, minus phi square in the functional, half minus phi square with a minus sign, but minus sign we will consider later when we form the this equation. So basically we want to find the phi square, half integral phi square dx. So now this phi square for element number 1, element number 1, again it is n1 phi is replaced by n1 phi 1 plus n2 phi 2 and square of that. So we have to just evaluate this integral. So it becomes simply this, is it not? If you expand this square, you will get this. So this integral expression can be further elegantly written in this form using matrices. So what are these matrices and what are these, particularly these elements, we will see now. So same expression is written, rewritten here, right? So now that original integral, this integral is now rewritten here with one change. Instead of twice phi 1 phi 2, we have just split that into two terms, phi 1 phi 2 into these two terms, and again phi 1 phi 2 into these two terms, right. So now this d 1 2 in this matrix is given by integral 0 to l x 2 minus x upon l into x minus x 1 by l dx, right. So it is obvious, because here if you expand this matrix equation, matrix expression, you can easily correlate that off diagonal term d12 will be this, right. Now if you evaluate this integral, you will get the answer as l by 6. Now this, all these off diagonal terms, they basically represent d12, d21 for element 1, d23 and d32 for element 2, and d34 and d43 for element 3, right. The diagonal terms are given by, for example, d11 will be given by this. d11 will be integral of this term. So that is integral 0 to l x 2 minus x by l square dx, which comes equal to l by 3. And in the corresponding, you know, if you evaluate it for various elements, then you will get d11 and d22 for element 1, d22, d2, d33 for element 2, and d33 and d44 for element 3. Remember that this is a 3 element example with 4 nodes, 1, 2, 3 and 4. Thus the element level D matrix then will be L by 6, 2, 1, 1, 2, because this is d11, d12, d21, d22, and their values are L by 6 for diagonal, off diagonal elements, and L by 3 for diagonal elements. Now let us again go back to the expression that we saw in the previous slide. So now this whole expression involving product of 3 matrices can be expanded to give you this. Now these 4 terms are just split here, right. Now remember, this is part of functional expression, is it not? This is part of functional expression. So this is the functional, is it not? And this is corresponding to element number 1. So this is representing only energy of element 1, and the corresponding functional, energy functional for the element 1 is written in this form. Same thing we are writing it here. So this is the energy for element 1 that is split into 4 terms. Now in the process of FEM method, what we are doing? We are doing energy minimization. So then we will have to differentiate with respect to first phi 1. Then if you differentiate this with respect to phi 1, you will get this, right. And noting that d21 is equal to d12, you will simply get this as d11 phi 1 plus d12 phi 2, right. Similarly, differentiating with respect to phi 2, you will get d21 phi 1 plus d22 phi 2. So combining this, then we will get the overall, after minimization, this whole term involving 3 matrices will just reduce to d times phi, and d matrix is d11, d12, d21, d22 into phi 1, phi 2, right. So this is what, after minimization, you get only d phi. Now let us see the source matrix. Now just to summarize, we started with this f, the overall functional, right, and the overall functional was this, and after minimization we would get a phi minus d phi equal to b. A we have already seen, which is a standard global coefficient matrix. D we just saw how to derive 2 by 2 coefficient matrix D for element 1, and similarly it can be done for other elements. Now we will see how to evaluate these B matrix elements, B matrix terms, which represent a source. So now the source term, now again this is for first element, that is why it is 0 to L, we are showing it only for the first element. So the source term will be integral x phi dx. Again just going back, here the source term is x here, when you take it on this right hand side it will become minus x, in the functional expression it will become x phi dx, right. So integral x phi dx, so that is what we are doing, integral x phi ds. So now this again x into phi, expression for phi is n1 phi1 plus n2 phi2, where n1 this is the shape function for node 1, shape function for node 2, right. And then again this can be written as elegantly in this form, product of two matrices, one row vector, one column vector. So now this b1, small b1 is given by integral from x1 to x2. Now instead of 0 to L, I have made here x1 to x2, so we can generalize, although we are doing this for the first element, then this can be, you know, if you are doing for the second or third element, corresponding first nodal coordinate and second, the coordinate corresponding to the second node can be you know put here, and the same expression can be used. So that is why I am, instead of 0 to L, because 0 to L will be valid for the first element, so I am generalizing it, so x1 to x2, first node coordinate and second node coordinate of the corresponding element. So b1 will be integral from x1 to x2, and then this term x into x2 minus x by L dx, and this phi1 anyway we are taking out in such matrix form. So b1 is given by this, after you know evaluating this integral we will get b1 expression as this. Similarly b2 will be integral x1 to x2, x minus x1 upon L into x, this x dx, and you after the evaluation you will get this. So now you can write this phi1 phi2 matrix into b1 b2 column matrix, you can write it like this, right. So these expressions for b1 and b2 are written here, so this is b1 and this is b2. After minimization, that means when we differentiate it with first with respect to phi1 and then with respect to phi2, you will simply get b1 and you will simply get b1 and b2 here, right. So this is the B matrix. So thus we have now understood how do we calculate all these matrices A, D and B, and these matrices, particularly this A and B, we have already seen in case of Poisson's equation, but this D matrix would be required when you are solving either wave equation or diffusion kind of equation. So now what we will do is, we will now start with the explanation of code, and here my PhD student Mr. B. Sairam, he has developed that code, so he will explain that code to you.
As we have discussed in the previous slide, we will be developing a one dimensional FEM code to solve a partial differential equation, one dimensional partial differential equation that we have been seeing in the previous lectures. So that one dimensional partial differential equation is as shown in the slide, so which is nothing but del square phi plus x equal to 0 with same boundary conditions, So the same equation that we have solved using whole domain approach and different approaches in the previous lecture manually, we will be now solving it using a code. So after applying FEM procedure, this partial differential equation will convert into a linear system of equations or a matrix equation of this form. Will convert into a matrix equation of this form, A phi minus D phi is equal to B. Okay. So in the previous lecture, and then this will again simplified into this form. So I am taking out this phi as common, and then that will result into A minus D, and that A minus D will I am calling it as K. Okay. And then phi I am assuming it as U. Are you getting? So what I am doing is, we are as we have seen in the previous lecture, the partial differential equation will be converted into a matrix form, and then that matrix form is then simplified into a Ax equal to B form. Here A is nothing but K, and X unknown matrix is nothing but phi, and source matrix is B. Okay. So this is clear na? Now in the previous lecture we have seen an example of a three element example, is it not? In the three element example, we have three elements and four nodes. Okay, so we have only three element coefficient matrices using which we formed a simple 4x4 matrix. Are you getting? Using three 2x2 element level matrices, we have formed a 1 4x4 matrix, and that 1 4x4 matrix we have reduced to a 2x2 matrix after applying boundary condition. Since the number of elements are less, it is obvious and it is simple to do manually. But if we increase the number of elements, then it will be very tough job to do it, to form those matrices manually. Even though if you form matrices, if it is a, if it is simply, let's say if I have chosen some 5 elements, let's say with 6 nodes, 5 elements and 6 nodes, then my global coefficient matrix will be of size 6x6, and after applying boundary condition my size reduces to 4x4. Then how can you take inverse of that? Manually doing that is very tough job. So such kind of operations we can easily do by using scientific computing softwares called like Scilab, MATLAB, Python, anything. Here in this course we will be seeing codes, we will be developing codes based on Scilab only. Why we have chosen Scilab is like the syntax, most of the syntax of Scilab and MATLAB are similar. So even in the code that I am going to demonstrate, you can see you can use most of the parts of that code in MATLAB directly. Only a few changes, one or two changes only will be there. The same code you can run in Scilab, the same code you can run in MATLAB as well. Clear? So that being said, we will now see what are all the steps involved in developing a code. Okay, from the first lecture of FEM module, we have seen FEM starts with choosing a geometry, discretizing the geometry, and then formulating element coefficient matrices, and then joining global coefficient matrix, applying boundary condition and solve it. You choose any partial differential equation that you want to solve using FEM, these are the only steps. Any partial differential equation, these are the only steps. Only in case of transient, we will be solving it every time, but the procedure will be same. Okay. So this code also I will be demonstrating in the same steps. Okay. So in the next lecture, we will see the complete coding procedure in Scilab. Thank you.
Okay. So we will stop here and continue next time. Thank you.